What a wonderful event, and how nice it is for all of you to come out. So welcome to the 9th Annual Elmhurst College Governmental Forum. We're gathered as part of the college's commitment to inform our citizens and community about issues that impact our everyday lives. Today is another special day in the college's mission. We are honored to have with us today our U.S. Attorney Zachary Fardon, along with two excellent presenters, Loyola Law School Dean David Yellen, and former prosecutor and Elmhurst College trustee Sergio Acosta, and as usual, our greatest alumni and trustee, Judge William Bauer. So thank you all for being here. So as we introduce the ninth annual Elmhurst College Forum, let me start by first thanking those that made this event so successful, and that, of course, is our sponsors. The sponsors for the 9th Annual Forum start with a group that has been there from the very start, AT&T of Illinois. I'm pleased to welcome and thank AT&T for its sponsorship and underwriting of today's event. For many years, AT&T has been our principal sponsor and is one of the state's largest employers with more than 15,000 employees. Thanks go to Paul Laschioza, the president of AT&T Illinois, and John Quinn, Director of External Affairs. Thank you, AT&T. Our gold sponsor, and every year I try to get our gold sponsor to come up and be our platinum sponsor, but continued as our gold sponsor, you know, you would expect that from somebody that has to raise money, right? Is, of course, the Inland Group of Companies. With over a 40-year history, the Inland Real Estate Group of Companies, Inc. is an industry leader and one of the nation's largest commercial real estate and finance groups. Please thank Chairman and CEO Dan Goodwin for their continued sponsorship of this event. Axion has joined us today. Axion Risk Management Strategies prides itself on being different. At Axion, they prioritize people over profit and build group insurance plans based upon their clients' needs, along with bundled benefit administrative services. A single approach never solves every challenge, so they've created a team that specializes in versatile, multi-year strategies that will grow with your business in a way that works for you. Thank you, Axion. Our silver sponsors, of course, one that has been there from the very start, Merrill Lynch, Bank of America, led by the Bolin Spears Group, Jim Bolin and Brian Spears. Thank you, Merrill Lynch, Jim Bolin, Brian Spears. BMO Harris Bank, Julie Curran is not only a trustee, Julie is trustee at Elmhurst College, but also heads up BMO Harris Bank and a sponsor, along with White & Company, Mark White, who is the college architect and good friend, Fifth Third Bank, Denise Beach, and of course the Munkus McCluskey Attorneys at Law. Ed Munkus is one of the leaders and the vice chairman of the Board of Trustees of Elmhurst College, along with Lake County Press, Jay Albanese, and this year's new sponsor, we're welcome, Ice Miller Legal Counsel, and led by Bob Schillerstrom, the chairman of the Illinois Toll Road. So thank you, Bob, and Ice Miller as well. On the bronze sponsors level, we have Walgreens returning, again, led by Joel Bays, GelCert Company, Ken Wegner, Novatex, Jerry Medina from Novatex, thank you for joining us this year, and K&M Printing. On the patron level, we welcome and thank Lincoln Property Company, Brian Byrne, BKD, CPAs and Advisors, led by Russ Romanelli, Green Tea, led by Joe Antonia Curry, and Truly Photography. Please also pay attention and recognize our VIP reception sponsor, the law firm of Franchek, Redelec, Scott Warner, and thanks to all the members of that firm for being with us. I'd also like to thank our in-kind donors and the student table sponsors, and they are listed in your program, so please take a look at them and give them a special thanks as well. So at this moment, thank you. Go ahead, you can thank them all. At this moment, as you do at these events, because it is a governmental event, is you thank our elected officials that are here today. So starting with our federal officials, I know we have two candidates for office, Tonya Curry and Pete DeCiani. Any other federal officials, candidates, or office holders, please rise and say thank you to our federal candidates, Tonya Curry, Pete DeCiani. our Senate and House members from the state of Illinois, those that are here today, we want to thank them, as well as our DuPage County-wide elected officials and DuPage County board members, led by Dan Cronin as chairman, and of course, many of our elected officials are here. So DuPage County elected officials, please rise so we could say hello to you and thank you for your service to all of us. And of course, any other county elected officials, we appreciate your being here as well. And the city of Elmhurst is here, led by our mayor, Mayor Morley, and other city officials. Thank you very much for being here. And of course, they're our hometown community, so we pay special recognition and honor to them. Our municipal and local government officials, as well as all other candidates for public office, thank you for being here today, and we appreciate your service. So before I conclude my remarks and let you have your lunch, which will last about 5 minutes before we get on our program. So you know what that means? That means eat fast and quick, but enjoy it nonetheless. So just a few program notes. Please turn off or silence your AT&T cell phone. Is that okay, John? Okay. And bathroom locations are outside and to your right as you leave. Promotional materials are in the reception area. Please feel to take them with you and ask any of our sponsors about their services. This forum is being recorded. This forum is being recorded and attacked on occasion and will appear in the near future on the college's website at www.elmhurst.edu. We encourage further conversation on Twitter to spread the word about the ideas and discussions we hear today. And that's hashtag ECGovForum16 or hashtag Elmhurst College. At the conclusion of the U.S. Attorney Fardon's remarks and questions posed by our presenters, we will have an audience question and answer session. Please write your questions on the cards located at the center of your table. At approximately 1:30, students will start circulating to pick up those questions for the panel. We will adjourn at or before 2 o'clock today. So we are really anxious and happy about the program we have. But if you don't mind, please join me in taking this look at who we are at Elmhurst College, what we do at Elmhurst College. So please pay attention to the video that I'm now going to show for you.
Elmhurst College is much more than buildings, courses, and credits. It's a supportive community of individuals who are committed to helping you reach your full potential. But don't take my word for it.
I visited a lot of schools, but when I came here, it was just like, I'm home.
As soon as I walked on campus, I felt like I could dive right in and get involved.
Getting involved is easy, especially in class. The average class here has just 17 students.
Every faculty and staff here just wants me to like succeed.
I can go up to them and it's not just office hours. Like I'm here from 10:30 to 11:30. It's actually like whenever you need help, my door's open.
There's a real connection that takes place. I'm frequently asked, what do I teach? I never say music. I teach people. Music's the vehicle.
It was great to see that rather than just teaching textbook material, they're actually giving you some industry insight.
I'm a vocalist. I'm out in the clubs performing. I'm touring in Europe and performing. So they see how their life can transition into that.
A lot of my friends from other universities, they don't get to be a part of undergraduate research, professional development at such an early stage.
They're truly there to help you and to build you and to make sure that you are amazing.
And at Elmhurst, you can be amazing all around, including on the field. Football is just one of 20 Division III sports.
We went straight to the Final Four of the nation, and that was a great way to come in and start off the season.
They're there because they're motivated to. They want to be a good team. They want to be a good player.
Wrestling wasn't my life. I was able to go out and do a lot of different activities and get involved on campus.
We are allowed to be students, and we can be involved in a lot of other things.
How do you want to get involved? You'll have your choice at Elmhurst.
Our campus has over 100 clubs and organizations.
Whatever you want to do, there's something here for you to do.
Concert choir, the wind ensemble, gospel choir,
Habitat for Humanity, Global Poverty Club.
I'm an orientation student leader, SGA,
Best Buddies.
Greek life at Elmhurst College is really focused on leadership and discovering who you really are.
To be part of all these different organizations and get to know all these amazing people
is why I love Elmhurst.
You can also get to know the world beyond the campus. Elmhurst offers study abroad opportunities in 44 countries.
I studied abroad in Granada,
Holland, Germany,
El Salvador,
Israel and Palestine,
Costa Rica,
Czech Republic.
Back at home, you'll enjoy all the advantages of our great location. Downtown Elmhurst is just a short walk from campus, and the Metro train will take you to the world-class city of Chicago in just 30 minutes. When it comes to career preparation, we've got you covered. Elmhurst will connect you with the people and the experiences you need to reach your full potential.
Elmhurst allows you to grow into the knowing, and I appreciate that there's a journey that we encourage. It's not just in one program or one department. It's threaded throughout everything that we do.
Elmhurst College pushes you to truly find who you are as a person and as a professional.
They will make sure no matter what your interests are, what your career path is, that there is going to be a resource on campus that is going to help you find that potential and then reach it.
Now listen to this. If a nation expects to be ignorant and free, it expects what never was and never will be. Today, those words are as true as the day they were spoken by Thomas Jefferson. They also highlight the very purpose of our commitment at Elmhurst College to higher education as one of the primary goals of a civilized society. We at Elmhurst College believe in a free society built upon the knowledge and the power of an educated citizenry. Democracy requires constant attention and vigilance, along with the consent of those that we govern. But it also requires those of us that are governed to remain involved and educated about the principles of government and the civics of government. Where there is a great discord throughout the world today, we acknowledge that there is a need for reaffirmation of the principles of democracy and freedom that made this country great. We at Elmhurst College will do our part to the extent we can to address the value of education as a civilized society. In that spirit, we are appreciative that you are here today doing your part as a governmental exercise. Following our mission of being a student-centered college over the last year, a theme of our college was developed and spearheaded by our interim president, Larry Braskamp. It speaks of reaching your potential, which is the greatest goal for any student today. This has become the guiding force of our college. Wherever you go on the campus, anywhere you go, you hear the comments and commitment to the theme of reaching your potential and what it means to be part of the Elmhurst College spirit. Recently, we asked a number of students at the college to talk about how Elmhurst is helping them to reach their potential. Here's what they had to say.
The teachers are extremely approachable.
The one-on-one interaction has really helped me find that passion.
I learned that no goal is too big.
They want you to network and then take risks because that's how it's going to be in your practical life.
They want us to succeed just as much as we do.
More of a learning experience, I think, outside of the classroom.
Various opportunities to really dive into different viewpoints.
Elmhurst fosters that environment of openness and everyone contributing to the greater good.
Elmhurst really challenges you to keep an open mind.
I went to Jamaica for 2 weeks. I came back with a whole new perspective.
They will make sure no matter what your interests are, what your career path is, that there is going to be a resource on campus that is going to help you find that potential and then reach it.
Through research, I've been able to go to all these new places, and I've also been able to really broaden my perspective.
We go in the field as pre-service teachers sophomore year.
I've exceeded what I thought at 18 years old walking on this campus that I could do.
Coming back to Elmhurst at my age has allowed me to see that yes, I have the potential to do other things.
And it's helped me grow to be a better leader.
I feel like I've been more prepared than I have ever been before in my life.
I don't want to be a blank slate. I want there to be lots of dimensions to me.
I'm going to be able to do something that's going to matter in this world.
I want to be that voice for people that can't speak up for themselves.
Without this school, I don't think I would have gone after those motivations or those dreams.
The people around me and the resources the school has allowed me to reach my potential.
I'm definitely ready for the real world.
Committed, dedicated, compassionate, knowledgeable, insightful, and focused are just a few of the descriptive adjectives used to describe our interim president, Larry Braskamp. Larry is an emeritus member of the College Board of Trustees, having served more than 9 years as a trustee in helping guide our college. On July 1, 2015, he, along with his wife, Judy, were called upon by the Elmhurst College Board of Trustees to serve as the college's interim president and first lady, while it conducted a national search for its 14th president. Little did he know the exact nature of the challenges that he would face. A slow economy, higher education being questioned on a national basis, and our state's failure to meet its responsibility to our financially needed students were only a few of those challenges. Faced with immense financial pressure, he informed the board that he would take the necessary steps to meet the challenges and work towards balancing the college's budget. It hasn't been easy, but he was committed to the college's future and turning over to the next president a fiscally sound condition. The challenges have been met. How lucky we at Elmhurst College are, and what foresight our Board of Trustees has shown to select an outstanding leader to guide us through these difficult times. Dr. Braskamp has served in various positions in higher education for over 40 years. He knows the system and used his immeasurable talents for the benefit of the college, its students, and communities within our area. He championed the City of Elmhurst and Elmhurst College Commission, highlighting the college's commitment to our broader community and helped forge a new partnership with the City of Elmhurst. He has never forgotten how our college always puts students first and established the goal of making sure that we all help guide our students to a meaningful and productive life. A noted scholar in his own right, Dr. Braskamp has made an incredible positive mark on our college, for which we are all grateful. His mark will be felt for years to come. As our new president, Dr. Troy Van Aken, takes over on July 1st of this year, he will do so with the knowledge that our college's mission of reach your potential is intact and that the college is fiscally sound. As I have mentioned on occasion in referring to Dr. Raskamp's good work, the words of Albert Einstein come to mind. Strive not to be a success, but rather to be of value. Dr. Braskamp, you have been an immense value to our students, our college, and our community. It's a wonderful legacy that you leave. Please join me in honoring and welcoming the man behind Reach Your Potential, our interim president, Larry Braskamp of Elmhurst College.
Doesn't Lee give tremendous introductions? If you've ever had that opportunity, you'd know. Thanks, Lee, for your effective leadership in this ninth annual government forum as well. As the interim president of Elmhurst, I want to welcome and to thank all of you for making this another great event. Elmhurst College, as you saw, is deeply committed to educating our students to become both productive professionals and to become good citizens in an ever-changing world. As you saw recently in these slides, we want students to reach their potential in all that they do, not just in their work, but as holistic persons, including being a good citizen. Today, these students who are here, and I'll ask them to stand up in a minute, are going to hear about what it means to be educated in a judicial system that is so important to our society. What I'd like to do now, actually, is ask all the students who are here to stand up and be recognized. Where are the all these students? There. Yeah, we've got here and here. Now, these are the Elmhurst College students. Now, let's ask the high school students to stand up. I know we have some from York High School back there. Please. Do the same. These are our future citizens, and it's really great to be a part of a college that is really educating them. I also want to now ask Elmhurst College alumni and parents of students at Elmhurst College to stand up. There's a lot of you who have been associated with Elmhurst College, so please stand. Look at all right. The spirit is alive at Elmhurst, as Lee said. Now I have the privilege of introducing a person who exemplifies good citizenship in every way. I am, of course, referring to the Honorable William J. Bauer, who will provide some opening remarks for our featured speaker. Judge Bauer, and we'll have him come forward at this particular point, as well as the other speakers. You can come on up and take your places. Let me tell you a little bit about Judge Bauer. Now, I know he really doesn't need an introduction to this crowd, but he really has had a remarkable life and still is reaching his potential, which all of us are still doing, is reaching our potential. Judge Bauer has been a member of the United States Court of Appeals for the Seventh Circuit since 1975. Before that, he served on the District Court for the Ninth District of Illinois, was the United States Attorney for the Northern District of Illinois, a judge of the 18th Judicial Circuit of the State of Illinois, and a state attorney for DuPage County. He is, of course, a graduate of Elmhurst College, the class of 1949. Judge Bauer is one of our college's most distinguished alumni, but he also is one of our most enduring friends. He has served as a trustee since 1976. That is a remarkable contribution. Thank you. He believes in service and in repaying personal and professional obligations. In a commencement address at Elmhurst College in 1982, here's what he said. "We all owe rent. The better our life, the more rent we owe. We pay our rent by service to mankind." And now the Honorable William J. Bauer.
I'm the least important speaker here because I have about 3 minutes to introduce people whose biographies are in your program, if you look carefully. We're going to talk about something, though, that's dear to my heart and should be dear to yours, too, and that's American justice and what its future is. Let me pause to tell you that the laws that are passed by our legislators and by both state and federal are not self-executing. Somebody has to enforce them, and that's the executive branch. The ones who decide who and what laws will be enforced against whom are the prosecutors. They have an enormous amount of power and discretion. The two most powerful weapons we give government as people are the power to make war and the power to indict. The power to indict is the power to destroy. So most prosecutors are very well trained in what the reason for the execution of the laws might be. They know they can destroy people simply by indicting them, not even by convicting them. It is of interest to me, I have been, as you heard, both a state prosecutor and a federal, that we turned down about 19 cases for every case we accept for prosecution. In the federal level, we don't worry about the election because they are appointed for a period of time by the President of the United States. And in the office held by our principal speaker today, politics plays no part in how you get the job. I take credit for a good part of that. When they wanted me to resign as a state judge to take the job of U.S. attorney, I said that I get to pick all the assistants. And if I get a call from Washington saying I cannot hire somebody or have to hire somebody for political reasons, I will resign out loud. And I can tell you, the first one I selected, by the way, was Jim Thompson. Four others succeeded me as U.S. attorney after that. But since then, they have never used any political litmus test. And I'm proud to tell you that Zach Fardon, the man who I'm about to tell you about, has carried that tradition on nobly. He himself was selected nonpartisanly when he was the assistant United States attorney. And he hires people on the basis of their ability, not on the basis of their political beliefs. And he has hired and added to a really great office. There is a difficulty in what we're going to talk about today, and that is justice means different things to different people. It is not a term that's capable of a simple definition. Some of you may have remembered several years ago, at one of these discussions, I worked with Bob Woodward, the author, and talk about truth and justice. We said the one difficulty was nobody could agree on what was truth, and nobody could agree on what was justice. It depends on where you are, which is the perfect lawyer's answer. It depends. So it is enormously important to have people in the office holding the job of either U.S. attorney, state's attorney, assistant state's attorney, to have a great sense of value and a sense of justice that is built in. I'm pleased to say the man that who is going to talk today has that. He will be worked over by two other men who are experts in the criminal field. Both are friends of mine. Both are permanently etched in my mind as men of decency, honor, and great lawyers. The Dean of Loyola University College of Law is here. He has proved that he knows how to educate people to follow out the rules we're talking about. And I congratulate him, and I am sorry he's going to leave. Sergio Acosta is over there. He is in the, serves on the board with me. He was an assistant United States attorney with Zach. And he, too, knows that he's now engaged with a very well-known law firm. And I'm going to tell you, he is a good defense lawyer, too. So in my business, they said he went to the enemy. May I introduce to you, however, the man who is now the moral force in federal law enforcement in Northern Illinois, one of the four premier offices of prosecution in the United States, Zach Fardon.
Thank you. First rule, never follow Judge Bauer. It's great to be here. You know, I was sitting in my office a couple of months ago at 219 South Dearborn, and I got a message that Judge Bauer would like to come down and see me, and I thought, well, that's sort of unusual. I wonder what he wants. And sure enough, later that afternoon, the judge came down to my office, and we sat down, and he handed me a letter, and he asked me to read it right then and there. And it was this great letter setting forth the history of the Elmhurst College Governmental Forum and inviting me to be this year's guest speaker. The judge waited till I finished reading the letter, and then he very politely asked me to think about it and let him know in the next few weeks if I'd be willing to do it. Now, for those of you here who have not yet figured this out, when a Seventh Circuit judge comes to your office and asks you to do something, you do not think about it. We have students in the room, certainly you students, certainly any future lawyers in the room. If you don't remember anything else I say today, tuck that one away. And this is not any judge. This is Judge Bauer, a true legend as a jurist and an instrumental, huge part of creating the culture of independence and integrity of the very office that I am now privileged to serve. Judge, if you had asked me to jump off the Wacker Street Bridge, I'd have gotten wet that day. I am honored to be here, and thank you for having me, sir. Now, Judge Bauer also picked the name of the title of my remarks, American Life and Law Justice in the 21st Century, and I'll admit on that one, maybe I should have stopped to think. It's a bit ambitious as I looked at it coming up on today's remarks, but here we are, and so I'm going to stretch for it. You know, we are living in truly extraordinary and challenging times for our justice system. We're experiencing turmoil, across the country right now on issues of policing and trust between police and the communities they serve. In our courts, we are right now revisiting our entire approach to sentencing, who we lock up, for how long, and why. And in our investigations, technologies testing our national priorities. International terrorists and other criminals are increasingly using the internet and social media to ply their trade, and with the explosive evolution of technology, including encryption, we're now in the midst of revisiting the age-old debate about how we as a nation want to strike the balance between government access to information versus protecting privacy rights. Any one of those three things, policing, sentencing reform, the encryption debate, is worthy of its own speech, better yet, worthy of its own full class at Elmhurst College. But I'm gonna do my best in the next 20 minutes or so to just provide some high-level observations and thoughts on those three huge issues facing us in the 21st century. Before I do, to give you just a bit more context about the U.S. Attorney's Office here, let me say a few words about it, who we are, what we do. The United States Attorney's Office for the Northern District of Illinois is part of the U.S. Department of Justice. There are 94 districts across the country, federal districts, and every one of those federal districts has its own U.S. attorney covering that district. Geographically, our district here includes Chicago and then west to the Iowa border, north to the Wisconsin border, and we have over 9 million people, which puts us among the very, very largest districts in the country. Broadly speaking, we are responsible for investigating and prosecuting federal crimes that occur in and impact this district. And on the civil side, we also defend the United States when it is sued, and we bring civil enforcement actions in areas like healthcare and civil rights. And to do all of that, our office here has a staff of about 300 people, about half of whom are lawyers, what we call, and you heard the judge reference, assistant United States attorneys, or AUSAs. Our AUSAs are divided between federal prosecutors on the criminal side in our criminal division, and then civil AUSAs in our civil division. And in my office, that divide is about 130 federal prosecutors to about 25 or so civil AUSAs. On that larger criminal side, we work daily with the federal investigative agencies like the FBI, DEA, ATF, IRS, as well as often with local and state law enforcement. And we are very much in a triage business. Because we have very limited resources, we focus federally on major crime, and the most common categories tend to be public corruption, terrorism, corporate fraud, major narcotics trafficking, and violent crime, including gangs. This U.S. Attorney's Office, our U.S. Attorney's Office, has a long history of aggressive but thoughtful use of our investigative powers and tools to get to the truth and to pick hard fights, and that's served us very well over the decades. Among other things, our office has taken out major organized crime figures dating back to Al Capone in the 1930s, and all the way other MAID members of the Chicago outfit in more recent years. We've prosecuted far too many governors and other public officials in this state. We've prosecuted countless corporate executives. We've prosecuted terrorists and terrorism financiers. And we've taken on some of Chicago's most violent street gangs. And those successes, decade over decade, have made Chicago one of the most storied U.S. Attorney's offices in the country. The secret to our success, in my view, is simple. We hire the best and brightest lawyers, and we maintain a culture of excellence that is second to none. We are a very proud office with a vigorous work ethic, a rigorous internal review processes, and an unwavering commitment to justice. It's not our job to win or lose. It is our job to do the right thing. We know that. That's a novelty for lawyers, and we love it, and we live by it. And as I said a few moments ago, Judge Bauer, decades ago, when he was the U.S. attorney, was instrumental in creating that culture. It still thrives, and I'm grateful to be a part of it today. Back to today's major challenges, starting with policing. In August of 2014, 18-year-old Michael Ferguson was shot and killed by a police officer in... Michael Brown was shot and killed by a police officer in Ferguson, Missouri. That incident ignited a powder keg of pent-up anger in Ferguson and beyond. Issues of force and race and racism and policing were thrust onto the national stage in a way that our country has not seen since the Rodney King beating in the 1990s. And unlike the Rodney King era, we now live in a time when video cameras are ubiquitous. Nearly every one of you has a video camera in your pocket as I speak, and you're two or three clicks from posting something on YouTube. And so in the wake of Ferguson, we began seeing viral videos in an almost constant drumbeat across the country. We saw Eric Garner die after a chokehold in Staten Island. We saw Tamir Rice, a 12-year-old with a fake gun, shot and killed in Cleveland. We saw clips of Freddie Gray before he died in the back of a police van in Baltimore. And of course, in Chicago, we saw 17-year-old Laquan McDonald shot 16 times by a police officer. And that's in the last 18 months. And there are many, many more examples. And every one of those videos and underlying incidents triggered not only an independent individual investigation, but they also triggered a broad national dialogue and movement around policing and improving trust between police departments and the communities they serve. And it is a movement, I believe, with nothing less at stake than public safety and effective self-governance and belief in our system of justice. That is manifest right here at home in December. The Attorney General of the United States, my boss, Loretta Lynch, announced a Department of Justice pattern and practice investigation of the Chicago Police Department. I was by her side in Washington when that announcement was made. And ever since then, my office has been working hand in hand with the Civil Rights Division of the Justice Department to conduct that pattern and practice investigation. Many of you probably heard over the past couple of weeks about the city of Chicago's Police Accountability Task Force, which announced its own findings and recommendations for reform at CPD, at the Chicago Police Department. That is separate and apart from our DOJ review, although we appreciate the work they did and we are carefully reviewing their recommendations. I want to pause to thank and commend my friend and former colleague in the office, Sergio Acosta, who was part of that Police Accountability Task Force. As I said, that's separate from our DOJ investigation, which is an independent investigation. It is not a criminal investigation. It's a civil investigation, the purpose of which is to determine if there is a pattern of constitutional violations by Chicago police officers. And we're focused particularly on two areas: use of force, including deadly force, and accountability mechanisms, including disciplinary hearings and how allegations of police misconduct are handled. We're in the midst of a very deep dive on those issues. Among other things, right now, we are analyzing a tremendous amount of data, both case-specific and general. We are interviewing hundreds of people, CPD officers and leadership, community stakeholders and leaders, union reps, anybody who touches the accountability process. We're conducting ride-alongs with patrol officers so we can see firsthand the realities and challenges that they're facing on the streets. We're looking soup to nuts at the standing policies and procedures of the police department. We're scrutinizing training, especially use of force training and de-escalation training. And we're conferring with top experts across the country in all of those areas. So it's an enormous undertaking. We have a large team of talented lawyers and staff here and in Washington, D.C., who are working on it. To what end? I'll give you the logistical answer, which is if our investigation determines that there's no pattern of violations, then we write a letter to the city saying as much. If, however, we find there is a pattern of violations, then we announce our findings and make recommendations for fixes. If we can negotiate with the city for implementation of those fixes, great. If not, then our recourse is to file a federal lawsuit here in Chicago and seek a court order mandating those fixes. So this is a major undertaking and investment by the Justice Department and for the city and the Chicago Police Department. I, for one, am honored to be a part of it. I think it is a positive, historic opportunity for the city and for CPD. I believe that police officers are the noblest of our public servants. They are women and men, citizens, who've made a decision to take a job at very modest pay where they wake up every day not knowing if they're going to get hurt or maybe killed. And in my experience, the vast majority of them have done that for one reason, and that is they care. They want to serve, they want to protect, they want to love and live impactful lives in our community. To do that, those good officers need the trust and respect of those that they are risking their lives to serve. For our system of justice to work, people have to believe in that system. If our DOJ review here can help restore belief, it will help restore trust and respect and make our city safer and stronger in Chicago. Now, as I said, our efforts here are part of a broader national movement. This same construct and principles are unfolding in different places across the country. Right now, we have seen an unprecedented number of DOJ pattern and practice investigations of police departments, large and small, across the country in the past few years, places like Ferguson and Seattle and Baltimore and Cleveland, and the list goes on. Change is hard. Treating wounds is painful, but they must be treated. And for us here in Chicago, my personal view is that while these are difficult times, what we have undertaken is important, and it is necessary, and it is due. Another national significant movement afoot in the criminal justice system right now is sentencing reform. Over the past few decades, we have become over-incarcerated as a nation. We have about 5% of the world's population, yet we have 25% of its prisoners. We have the highest rate of imprisonment, total prisoners against total population, of any nation in the world, higher than Russia, China, Brazil, India, England. Since 1994, the number of prisoners in our federal system has more than doubled, and it won't shock you to hear me say that costs money, lots of it. We as a nation are spending about $81 billion on prisons and detention. Let me personalize it. Our Federal Bureau of Prisons is part of the Justice Department, the same agency I work for. And currently, about 30% of our DOJ total budget is going to prisons and detention. By contrast, less than 8% goes to fund all United States Attorney's offices across the country, all of them. So we're spending way more money on prisons and detention than we are on prosecuting criminals in the first instance. A few years ago, those trends triggered a review in the Justice Department to determine how we got to where we are, and that led to an assessment that, among other things, the mandatory minimum sentencing laws for drug crimes had crowded our prisons. In the 1980s and 1990s, Congress passed the mandatory minimum laws as a tool to combat drug trafficking. Laudable goal: serious narcotics kill people. Having said that, over the years, those mandatory minimum laws resulted in lengthy prison terms for a large percentage of federal offenders. And in looking back, in some of those cases, particularly where there was no history of violence, the Justice Department began to question whether the length of those terms was necessary, was proportionate, was in the interest of justice. And then a seminal moment occurred in the fall of 2013 when then Attorney General Eric Holder launched an initiative called Smart on Crime. Now, in many ways, I wish it had not been called that, because I think for some folks, the title Smart on Crime carries with it the implication that past practices were dumb on crime, and I do not buy that. The fact that approaches of the past may not be right for the future doesn't mean dumb then versus smart now. But whatever you think about the title, it is the substance of the policy that matters. And Smart on Crime represents fundamentally a pivot in the Justice Department's approach with regard to sentencing of low-level, nonviolent drug defendants. It says, essentially, as to those folks, rather than seek the mandatory minimum prison terms that Congress has allowed us to seek, let's instead broaden sentencing discretion of our bench. Let's allow the sentencing judges to determine on a case-by-case basis appropriate sentences for those defendants without regard to the mandatory minimum prison terms. And so for over 2 years now, that's what we across the country at the Justice Department have been doing, and that has resulted in substantially fewer lengthy prison terms for nonviolent offenders. A similar evolution has been occurring outside of the Justice Department over the past few years. In 2014, the United States Sentencing Commission, which is comprised of federal judges, reduced the federal sentencing guidelines for all narcotics trafficking offenses, and they made that retroactive, that reduction, which resulted in reduced sentences for over 26,000 offenders. And then last year, 2015, the White House also launched a clemency initiative overseen by the Justice Department and aimed at currently incarcerated drug defendants, the purpose of which is to go back and reassess those sentences and determine whether or not it is appropriate to grant further commutations. And then lastly, right now as I speak, there is sentencing reform legislation bouncing around the Hill in Washington, D.C. that attempts to address these same issues and create a new sentencing regime reflective of modern times. So there's a lot happening right now in this category of sentencing reform. The times, they are a-changing. I'm gonna offer you just a couple of quick personal opinions, just my opinions, about those changes. The first of which is, I think these initiatives, by and large, make sense. I think both fiscal reality and proportionality in sentencing call for change. It won't surprise you to hear me say that I believe our office here has done its work with integrity over the decades, but that does not mean that the policies and practices of the past are right for the future. I believe that the debate and evolution that we are seeing is a healthy one. The second point I want to make, though, is that while I believe reform is prudent, I also think that we need in appropriate cases, harsh sentencing, including lengthy prison terms. My office brings cases against a lot of dangerous defendants or defendants who, in whatever context, have caused enormous harm to the district and to its citizens. And for our federal criminal justice system to continue to play the meaningful role that it has in this district, it needs to be one willing to mete out justice, whether that means probation or life imprisonment. And so while I embrace the saner aspects of this pendulum swinging, I also hold dear the importance of meaningful punishment in appropriate cases. Last thing I'm going to touch upon is the encryption debate. I'm sure many of you paid attention over the past few months as the battle lines got drawn between the Department of Justice and Apple over unlocking an iPhone used by one of the killers in the San Bernardino mass shooting. That phone was actually held in the custody of San Bernardino County, where Syed Farouk had been employed at the time he helped murder 14 people in the name of ISIL. The government obtained a warrant to search that phone, but needed assistance in execution of that warrant, circumventing encryption technology. And so we went to Apple for their assistance, and Apple balked. And so DOJ went to court to order their compliance. The issue went away in that particular case when the FBI was able to crack the code with the assistance of a third party. But the debate rages on, and in fact, we're now facing similar situations in different districts across the country. There are different kinds of encryption software being used in different smart devices, and so DOJ continues to seek court assistance, mandating assistance with the execution of lawfully obtained search warrants. And this issue is not going away anytime soon. The director of the FBI, Jim Comey, testified not long ago before the House Intelligence Committee in Washington that this issue is the hardest issue he has seen in government. And for those of you not familiar with Mr. Comey or his resume, he is a former Deputy Attorney General in the Bush administration. He's a former Deputy Attorney General of the United States. He's also a former United States Attorney in Manhattan. He is a smart, experienced, terrific public servant rest assured when Jim Comey says this is a hard issue, it is a hard issue. You know, the question of how we want to strike the balance between security interests and privacy rights is not new. In the 1960s, this nation debated that exact question around the passage of the Title III laws, which are the laws that first allowed law enforcement to seek court-authorized wiretaps of telephones. So here we are again, except instead of rotary phones, we now have these. Like I said, nearly every one of you has one in your pocket, and the world has become infinitely more complex. It's passé to say that technology's changed the world. It's very practical for me to look around this room and say these things have changed everybody's life in this room. This is where we store our lives, our personal data, our family and friend information, our financial information, our business and work communications, and often our most intimate conversations and secrets, right here. And so the nature of the intrusion has become categorically different. Simply said, there's more at stake. There's another part of the backdrop here, in my opinion, with regard to this issue being so complex in the modern world, and that is not one that I think gets talked about as much. I haven't heard anybody in government talk about it, but here I am. And that is, you know, the erosion of trust in the federal government. I do think, dating back to the Snowden revelations of, you know, mass data collection, and further reflected through the civil unrest over the past few years, I mean, we got to face the reality that a lot of folks just don't trust the government. I think there are those, and I believe they are in the minority, who don't trust the government's motives. But even among those who trust the government's motives, there are those who don't think that the government is a capable custodian of private data, especially every nook and cranny inside this machine. And so the issue, this issue, has gotten starkly more complex than it's ever been in our nation's history. There are no easy answers. I'm not here to offer easy answers. This ultimately may well require a legislative fix, and of course that will take time, to say the least. And in the meantime, I want to offer you two things to think about as this debate continues, because it will continue. The first of which is, this is not just a counterterrorism issue. The initial fight with Apple came in the context of a counterterrorism case, but the issue is much broader than that. Encryption and the issue of going dark threatens our investigations, the government's ability to investigate and prosecute crime in every key area: violent crime, gangs, fraud, public corruption, human trafficking, you name it. So let's be clear about what's at stake from a law enforcement perspective. My second point is that despite some perceptions or critiques, the government is not operating in the wild, wild west in this debate. In every single one of these cases, the government went through the judicial gatekeeping function to obtain a lawful court order based on probable cause that a crime had been committed and that there was evidence of that crime on that device. And so the judicial gatekeeping function, that protection against unwarranted invasions of our privacy, is as alive and healthy as ever before. It's my view that there are a couple of really hard questions that we as a nation are going to have to grapple with to figure out where we land. And the first is a loaded one, but it is what it is. Can we have searches in the digital age without requiring technology companies to provide assistance where they've developed otherwise impenetrable encryption technology? And if the answer to that is no, we can't, then I think the second question is, what does that mean from the perspective of these things as a safe haven for criminals and for criminal activity? It's a heady question, as are the questions with regard to policing in the modern world and sentencing reform in the modern world. They're all heady questions and exciting and important. In every case, I believe that finding answers to those questions will require careful analysis and measured circumspection and balance. Balance is hard, and yet I believe the solution to nearly every important question in life requires balance. So we will find that balance. We will succeed as a Justice Department and as a nation. Our commitment to justice is unwavering. I'm grateful to be a part of it. I'm looking forward to your questions. I'm hoping these guys will take it easy on me. And I just want to thank you again for having me, and I want to thank Judge Bauer once again for everything you have done for this district and for this U.S. Attorney's Office.
Zach, thanks very much for those remarks. I know we all appreciate it. I'd like to remind the people here, if you have questions that you'd like for us to ask of Zach, please write them down. I know there are people out collecting them. They'll bring them up here, and we'll make sure we try to get to everyone's questions. Let me start off by asking you, Zach, out here in the western suburbs, for several years now, there has been real concern with the prevalence of heroin use and abuse by high school students and others. Could you tell us what role your office and federal law enforcement in general plays in trying to do something about that that epidemic?
Well, a big one, now more than ever. It is an epidemic, it's a crisis, it's a national crisis. It's worse here than it is many places, although, you know, there are different cities and districts across the country that are struggling madly with this issue. You'll appreciate this, Sergio. Last year, more than 70% of our narcotics trafficking intake in the office, new cases that we're investigating in the office, are heroin trafficking cases. You only got to go back a couple of years to where that was flipped, and it was mostly cocaine trafficking cases. We have about one person dying a day in the greater Chicago area. I'll include DuPage, Lake, Cook counties. A person a day dying from heroin overdoses or heroin-related deaths. And that is insane. We do have a higher addiction rate here than is occurring nationally. I think the national state treatment admission rate for heroin is 16%. Ours is around 25%. I saw a survey where kids 18 and under in the state of Illinois were asked, you know, with anonymity assured, whether they'd used heroin in the last year, and 3.8% said yes. That's like four kids out of every 100. It's outrageous. And so it is, that all of those things make it a federal problem. It's a public safety problem, it's a health problem, and it's something that we are spending a lot of time and resources to take on. Just quickly, and I could talk about it for quite a while, but a couple of key ways that we're plugging in. The first is on the enforcement side. Obviously, it's our job to prosecute, you know, people who break the law. And we're doing that with regard to heroin trafficking, both at a local distribution level. Last year, we had an operation that took out the largest west side of Chicago heroin open air market in the city, 42 defendants as part of that case. So we're bringing those cases, but we're also going after the people bringing it into the district. And it is principally Mexican cartels, Sinaloa cartel, Juarez, Zetas. And we have been bringing indictments against the leadership of those cartels, particularly Sinaloa, Chapo Guzman, who is the CEO, in essence, of that cartel, and many others, some of whom we've already extradited and brought to justice, others we're working toward. But we are spending a lot of time and resources focused on attacking the supply side. The other thing, though, that we're doing is on the demand side, which is we're not going to prosecute our way out of this heroin problem. Anybody here who thinks that, you know, needs to dig deeper. We have to do a better job of education and prevention, and there are two pieces of that to make from my perspective. One of which is what I'll call diversion, but the addiction to prescription medications, to opioids. Hydrocodone, oxycodone is a gateway, it's a precursor to heroin addiction. There is a downward spiral that you see recurringly in these heroin overdose cases where folks are addicted to opioids and then they end up using heroin and dying. And we have to deal with the reality that I talked about the prison populations earlier. 5% of the world's population, we consume over 90% of its hydrocodone. What's that about? We have to find a way not to have opioids ubiquitous in our country, and I think that from an enforcement perspective means going after pharmacies pharmacy employees, docs, who intentionally, illegally divert prescription meds, but also on a regulatory basis, we got to figure out a way to tamp down on that. But the other thing, the other piece I wanted to mention is education and prevention. People need to better understand the problem. We need to talk in our churches and in our schools and in our homes about the danger of taking that OxyContin or taking that hydrocodone and what this downward spiral can look like. The FBI has just made a movie. It's on FBI and DEA's website. It's called Chasing the Dragon. Those of you not familiar with this might find that interesting, because I think it kind of gives you some real world examples of how that works. But so yeah, we're plugging in. The DEA in Chicago is magnificent, and they're throwing all, it's their number one priority. They're throwing all their resources at attacking this heroin problem. It's deep, it's complex, and so it is a federal problem, and we're doing what we can in partnership with our local and state authorities.
First, let me congratulate Zach for those really thoughtful remarks, and I don't know if the audience could tell, it was all delivered without notes, which was pretty remarkable. You know, as someone who has been involved in criminal justice reform for a long time, and I was working in Congress when some of the mandatory minimum sentencing laws that are now being scaled back were passed, and you know, some of us were working against them at the time. One thing I just wanted to mention was, I think a big reason why the term smart on crime was used for this latest round of reforms is that back in the 80s and 90s, you were either tough on crime or soft on crime, and people were losing elections because they voted against some of the policies that we're now rethinking. So I think smart on crime is actually a nice way to reconceptualize the debate.
Helpful context. Nonetheless, some people have had a negative reaction to that title, but I appreciate the context.
So one issue that struggles for attention, and we were talking about a little bit at lunch, is reentry of ex-offenders. Not only do we have the most punitive sentencing system in certainly the developed world, really the whole world, but we also are among the harshest in the world in how we treat ex-offenders. And so I just wonder about your thoughts on that as we try to find ways to reintegrate ex-offenders into society so they become productive members of the community and don't, or at least reduce the likelihood that they're going to be recidivists. Do you think there's more we need to do in that regard?
Absolutely. And, you know, it is a question that's getting asked more and more. This week happens to be National Reentry Week. The White House, as part of this criminal justice reform, has proclaimed that. But it's not a new question. It's just not historically gotten the attention it deserves. Every year in the state of Illinois, we have tens of thousands of prisoners coming out of IDOC, the Illinois Department of Corrections, and other prison facilities, and reentering our society. And often in the very neighborhoods, the most violence-afflicted neighborhoods in the city of Chicago. And those individuals are and were statistically much more likely to recidivate, to commit additional crimes upon their release. And in some cases, you know, bad guys are just bad, but in most cases, in my opinion, it is that they just don't have other opportunities or avenues to survive. And I do think that since 2001, our office, the U.S. Attorney's Office here, has had a program as part of our Project Safe Neighborhoods where we've been conducting forums, what we call our reentry forums. We have those every month. We move around to different neighborhoods in Chicago, and we are meeting with reentering felons to, you know, both deliver a message of prevention, which is to say, I've been to some, and AUSA from my office goes, and we talk about what's going to happen now that you're a convicted felon if you go out and pick up a gun or commit another crime. So there's a deterrent message, but more importantly, we have, you know, community providers and social service providers that are there to offer them help and support, from how to prepare a resume to, you know, getting a haircut, or, you know, what you can do to start getting on a pathway to a better life. And we had partnered with the University of Chicago from the outset of that program so that it could be sort of empirically established, the efficacy of it, and that is over and done. We have now more than a decade's worth of research from University of Chicago of how and why those reentering felons who attend our forums are less likely to commit additional crimes than those who do not, period, hard stop. So it is, it's an issue that's been years in the making, but is upon us now, and especially with, you know, an increase, if anything, in the number of reentering felons, we have to do a better job of creating a world where there are opportunities for those folks who have done their time and deserve, you know, to have full and successful lives as much as you or me. We need to find a way to create better pathways to give them those opportunities. Huge challenge, and you know, I think it's something that people should be asking themselves and trying to bring their resources to bear to push in that direction, because it is, I think, very much part of what we need to be focused on at the first part of this century.
Great. Zach, let me ask you a question about things that are happening right now. There, we read every day in the newspapers about an explosion of violence and shootings in the city of Chicago. Double the number from last year. What's going on, and what can you, in working with local law enforcement in the city, do to try and get that situation under control?
That's an easy question, Sergio. So let's move on to the next question. You know, it is at the end of February, we were up over 100% shootings and homicides in the city of Chicago. We're now, that those numbers have trended in a more positive direction. We're now over 60% as opposed to over 100%. I'm talking year over year last year to this year. Trending the right way right now, unacceptable. I mean, just horrifying. And believe me, I've lost sleep every night this year over this issue. You know, I do think in terms of what is going on, nobody can say with certainty, but late last year, it's no secret to say that we had, you know, a series of successive, quick, significant events that included the release of Laquan McDonald video, the announcement of a pattern and practice investigation of the Chicago Police Department, the firing of a longstanding CPD superintendent. And then coincidental to all three of those things, in January, on January 1st, a deal went into effect between the ACLU and the city of Chicago for contact cards, enhanced paperwork that officers have to fill out when they conduct stops. Stops went way down in January and February of this year. They're still down year over year from last year. When I say stops, I mean just any occurrence of stopping somebody on the street and asking questions or otherwise having an interaction, whether or not it leads to an arrest. Down more than 90% year over year from last year as of the end of February. Again, that's trending otherwise, but it's startling. I do think that it's been said, and it's fair to sort of observe that there is a drag on morale in light of the various things from a law enforcement perspective, in light of the all of those things happening in very quick succession. I already said my piece on police officers who are my colleagues and I know and love, and I know that they will get out there and do their jobs as they need to do, but these have been tough and challenging times. And at the same time, I also think that there is a sense of impairment of legitimacy of law enforcement that on some level has emboldened some criminals in some places to be quicker on the trigger than they historically would. That's a very imperfect, inexact, and subjective answer to why we may be seeing some of these trends, but it's an honest answer. We are all hands on deck in terms of what we're doing about it, and by we, I mean my federal law enforcement partners. I'm talking to the head of the FBI, DEA, ATF, and other agencies, as well as CPD, the interim superintendent, and now the current superintendent, and other leadership on an almost daily basis about when, where, what we can do to help. I mean, part of the challenge is that it's not like these are terribly well-organized shootings or homicides that we're seeing. Generally, you're talking about drive-bys, about impetuous, impulsive shootings, often driven by social media spats. And so the nature of the challenge is maybe a little different than it was 15, 20 years ago when it was more about organized gangs fighting over drug turf. And so we are making a concerted effort to track that social media and to focus on the areas where we think we can have a law enforcement impact and get in front of the violence. And we are certainly ramping up right now from a federal perspective our enforcement efforts. We've been long committed, and you know that, to the fight against violent crime, but we're doing more right now than ever on the gun front and on the gang violence front. But I'll also say, and I've spoken about this in various contexts, I've given a couple talks at the City Club about this, no different than heroin, we're not going to rest our way out of this problem. And I do think that it's easy to want to react to numbers, good or bad. I mean, 2014, we had the lowest homicide rate in the city of Chicago we've had since 1965. Last year, it was up a little bit, but it was our increase was lower than the national increase, and it was still one of the lowest precedent years in terms of homicide rate in the city of Chicago since the late 1960s. And, you know, was anybody happier patting themselves on the back? You didn't get as much attention in the media, but no is the answer to that question. We have kids dying. We have neighborhoods in the city of Chicago that are set apart, that are unfairly afflicted by violence. That's a social justice issue. And we have to recognize that it's not just a law enforcement issue. It is a poverty issue. It is a joblessness issue. It is an economic and educational equality issue. And we have to take those issues on. We have to keep a long view. We have to figure out a way to create a better world for the young people growing up, particularly in those most violence-afflicted neighborhoods. And thank you. And those are they are wonderful sentiments and proclamations, but I couldn't be more earnest about it in including the long view. I mean, I do believe that we have to come together around something more akin to a Marshall Plan, a more unified decision and effort about how we can create infrastructure and resources that will enable kids to pick a path other than gang violence. Many of you may not know this, but kids in the most violence-afflicted neighborhoods in the city of Chicago are gang affiliating right now, first, second, third grades. That's how young they're doing it. And it's not nefarious at the time. It's not as though they're doing it and getting a gun in their hand and going out and slinging dope. It's a network. It's an association. It's their cousin. It's their brother. It's their friend. And over time, they end up at 13, 14, 15 years old being in a position of holding a gun and being asked to do something with that gun. They're doing it because they don't have another pathway. They don't have visibility into options for self-identity other than the gang option. And we as a society have to create that visibility for those kids. And that's not an adult penal system issue. That's not a criminal justice system issue. That is a across the board societal issue that I think the business community, the civic community, the governmental entities, and the Department of Justice, my office, all have to figure out how to come together and put our weight behind.
Zach, just to follow up a little bit, whether or not issues about police morale and constraints on their conduct are influencing violent crime rates right now, and I know that's not the only thing you were saying. Personally, I'm skeptical of that, and I would just point out that Chicago has not done nearly as well over the last 10 years in reducing violence, homicides, as all the other largest cities in the country. So even if 2014 and 15 were better than 2016, 2014 and 15 in Chicago were way worse than in New York and Los Angeles.
I'll fight with you a little bit on that. Not way worse. They were certainly New York has realized reductions that are much more striking than Chicago, LA to a lesser degree. But there are other cities like Washington, D.C., like New Orleans, that are comparable right. cities that have as bad or worse problems as we've had. So yeah, but point taken, but I just not quite as categorically.
Yeah, fair point. Depends who you're comparing to. But let's talk about looking forward and productive developments that may come. You know, the task force that Sergio was on just issued its report, which was very scathing about the police culture as to racial attitudes and conduct. You know, I was involved in the Burge investigations yep. in recent years, and it's a horrible chapter in Chicago's history. There are other cities that have come through rough times in police and community of color in particular relations, and whether it's because of a pattern or practice investigation or a lawsuit, there are steps that have been taken that lead to improvements in policing and police community relations. What's the optimistic view of what might happen in the next few years to improve that situation in Chicago?
David, I'll tell you point blank. This pattern and practice investigation is something I asked for, I wanted, I pushed for. It is, as I said, important, necessary, due. And that is, to me, there's nothing incongruous about viewing, as I do, CPD as my partner and having profound gratitude and respect for those brave officers that are doing what they're doing and wanting them to be as good as they can be. If there are problems, we need to fix those problems. We have to get to a place where when police are conducting homicide investigations, people feel safe and secure and trusting that the police will, they can share their information with the police. We have to push back against this anti-snitching culture, in other words. And I do think some of that comes back to the history of CPD and issues within CPD that have caused people to reach the conclusions they've reached. I'm not going to comment or prejudge where our investigation, the pattern practice investigation, leads, but I do think that is, when I say historic, positive opportunity, that's what I mean. Here we are, we needed to take it on, we're taking it on. I've already commended Sergio, I won't do it again. But, it is optimistic, and I am optimistic. It's painful, we're going through a difficult time, but you know what, a lot of things, good things that come in life require pain, right? It requires time, it requires effort, it requires persistence. And I believe that we're undertaking the efforts and initiatives that we need to get to a better place. Whether that takes a year or years or decades is, and again, I don't mean to sound Pollyannish or selfish, but is less important to me. That if you look at our violent crime issues in the city of Chicago, these are generational issues. These are longstanding issues. They're rooted in the history of this nation, including, yes, our cardinal sin of slavery and oppression and unfair treatment of disfavored groups in this country. I don't think it's mysterious to say that. I think it's just a recognition of the truth. We're evolving, we're in a different and better place, and we've got to keep with, I believe, a long view, pushing in this direction and doing everything we can collectively to make sure that we get to a good place. May not sound like it, I am optimistic. I'm optimistic because this is my adopted home. But I'll tell you, to this moment, I couldn't be more profoundly impressed by the city of Chicago, by the philanthropy, by the wisdom, the leadership of its people. I see it on the bench. I see it in our office. I see it in the private sector, certainly from a legal perspective. I see it through the academic institutions. Yes, we have problems, but I'll be darned if this is not a great city with the talent, the ability, the passion, and the goodwill to get where we need to get. And I think we just got to keep our heads down and keep pushing in that direction.
Now, I haven't seen any cards. If we have any, well, and I have seen a microphone floating around. I don't know if people in the audience, if you want to maybe raise your hand if anyone has questions.
No questions is okay.
Okay. All right. Very good.
Here's the cards.
Oh.
Here's some cards.
All right. Thank you so much. Right. Yes. Zach, this comes from a political science student at Elmhurst College. Question. Many of us are concerned that Muslims are being unfairly profiled by law enforcement. What steps has your office taken to avoid discrimination against all citizens and especially Muslims? And if I could just add a little bit to this question. In our national political debate, there has been discussion by some people about having special patrols of Muslim neighborhoods and areas and so forth. Could you also speak to federal law enforcement's engagement with the Muslim community in terms of counterterrorism work?
Yeah, sure. It's a great question, and thank you for it. It's an important question. I don't normally, refer to my own either speeches or writings, but Michael Anderson is the special agent in charge of the FBI, and he and I co-wrote a letter that was published in the Sun-Times last week on this very issue, the essence of which was, our Muslim community in the city of Chicago is a key partner to us in the effort against terrorism. And we need to recognize that and make sure that we, now more than ever, are pushing back against bigotry and xenophobia. I mean, contextually, events like Brussels, Paris happen. It fosters fear and hate. That's part of ISIL's objective. And, you don't have to stretch your neck too hard to, in this country and in this community, to hear rhetoric, xenophobia, bigotry against Islam, against immigrants or potential immigrants or citizens of Muslim faith, and that is wrong. I categorically reject any notion that these acts are religious acts. They're not. They're acts of criminal barbarianism. Barbarian it? I don't know if I can say that word. But it is a timely and major issue, and our federal law enforcement is committed and has to be committed toward certainly preventing, disrupting bloodshed in our district and beyond. And we committed a lot of time and resources to that. My office has a national security section with now about a dozen AUSAs in it. And unlike any other section in the office, that section is not, its principal objective is not enforcement, it is prevention. And we plug in with the counterterrorism squads at the FBI to foster that. And a key partner for us is the Muslim communities. We have over 200,000 Muslims in the greater Chicago area, and they're mothers and fathers and school teachers and doctors and lawyers and business leaders, just like any other citizens. And the mosques are anything other than safe havens for radicalization. They care more than anyone about not allowing their kids to become radicalized. They care more than anyone, as much as anyone, about making sure our communities are safe and secure. We in our office, and I, since I've been in this position the last 2.5 years, have connected with and continue to connect in all sorts of ways, micro and macro, with the Muslim community in Chicago. We have quarterly roundtables where we meet and go through, talk about issues of the day. I also have held community trust roundtables where we've had representatives of the Muslim communities participate in those. And then the FBI is very proactive in terms of outreach and visiting mosques and knowing the leadership. And again, it is a terrific collaborative work environment that we enjoy with our Muslim partners and stakeholders. But back to the broader issue that was asked on the card, that's my honest perspective from a federal law enforcement position. That doesn't cure the issue of suspicion, racism, bigotry, xenophobia on the street. I think that's why I wanted to write the letter that we wrote last week to the Sun-Times. I think saying it and being cognizant of that kind of fear and hatred and what it can foster and how that festers is what you have to do to start the conversation, to get those folks that might be even unconsciously reaching those conclusions to kind of recognize those reactions and push back against them. And so it's an ongoing challenge, but one we're certainly doing what we can, and I feel strongly that we're going to continue to work with our Muslim partnership to make sure that that both we do what we have done, which is protect the homeland, but also that there isn't that kind of racism in our streets.
Zach, we have another question about you personally, that you pointing out the fact that you ran in the Boston Marathon the year of the terrorist bombing there. Could you just briefly describe for us what that was like and whether or not that had any effect on you in your approach to your job?
I did not expect that question. It was one of the most profound emotional experiences of my lifetime, Sergio, is the honest truth of it. I'm lucky enough to have a dad that convinced me when I was in college to run a marathon. And believe me, when I was in college, I was doing other stuff. But he convinced me, probably because of that, he convinced me to run a marathon. And so I'm not one of these crazy marathons all the time people, but every few years I get to scratch and go out, have gone out and run one. Had qualified for Boston before, but had never run it. And my dad, who had, convinced me, you got to go check that box. And so in 2013, I went to run Chicago for the first time in my life. It was a ridiculously beautiful, perfect day. Boston's like no other urban marathon. It's these, you go through these hilly, bucolic New England neighborhoods. You start 26 miles out of town and you run all the way to Boylston Street downtown. And so I ran and I had a great day, a great race across the finish line. Unfortunately, because of my work commitments, I literally showered in a sink and then got in a cab with my dad, who was with me, and headed for the airport. Got to the airport, and at the airport, learned that well after I had finished the across the finish line, these bombs had gone off. My dad, who was there spectating, he's not running marathons anymore. He was standing same side of the street, same block as bomb one, about 50 yards or so from where that bomb went off, and people were killed and limbs were lost. And you know, I'm still numb from it. I learned after that of something called survivor's guilt. I felt, you know, I wanted to be back at the scene. I didn't understand how and why I'd just been by there and there are other runners and spectators who were hurt and we weren't. I was grateful for that, but it's an odd emotional thing to go through. And so, you know, how does that inform my view today? Only in that it gives me a more profound appreciation for the treachery, the damage, the harm that these terrorist acts, and especially with organizations like ISIL that focus on soft targets, vulnerable victims, unprotected environments, and makes me that much more committed and disciplined in wanting to make sure that those kinds of things don't happen again. That's not unique to me, but it's always that experience with Boston is always in the back of my head and is in my heart when I am dealing with counterterrorism issues. I did go back the next year, only for the sake of going back. I felt like I had to, and ran again. That was the last marathon I've run, and I don't have any plans to do another one anytime soon.
Zach, let me ask you this, another question. This goes directly to the theme of your talk today. Cybercrime is a crime wave of the new millennium. Are you pursuing it? And if so, how?
Another huge question and good question. The answer is yes. In April of 2014, about 6 months after I started, we made some changes to the organizational structure of the U.S. Attorney's Office, and part of that was formalizing a cyber crimes section. We married it with national security, so it's a national security and cyber crimes section. That is because of the confluence of those two subject matters, but also we have a robust pipeline of standalone cybercrime, setting aside counterterrorism, just cybercrime cases. You know, the internet is how criminals ply their trade these days. It is a vector for criminal conduct in all sorts of different arenas. And a lot of de jure issues are around hacking and the data theft. But also significant traditional frauds that are occurring through cybercrime, narcotics trafficking that is occurring through cybercrime over the internet. And those cases and investigations present unique challenges, technology challenges, investigatory strategic issues, and legal issues that you need to have a standalone practice area to develop that expertise to be able to be effective and wise in developing the evidence, making cases, charging cases. We have charged a number of good cybercrime cases in the last couple of years. I will tell you that there's more good stuff coming. And it is something that we're gonna have to, it's part of today's reality. We're gonna have to continue to bring significant resources to bear. The FBI also has ramped up quite a bit, both its expertise and its manpower to combat cybercrime. So it's a very important programmatic area for us.
Lee, can I just say one last thing real quick? I've had the opportunity to know a lot of U.S. attorneys around the country under both Democratic and Republican administrations, and in general, they've been just a really, truly outstanding group of public servants. Somehow, going back to Judge Bauer's influence and days, Chicago has been blessed with a particularly extraordinary group of U.S. attorneys over a long period of time.
But I think you can all see why we're really lucky to have Zach in this role for us right
Thank
now.
Thank you, Dave. Thank you very much. Thank you.
An Elmhurst College jacket.
Thank you. Thank you, Lee. Appreciate that.
So I just gave them an Elmhurst College jacket. You would expect that. We would give them an Elmhurst College jacket. And Judge Bauer, you probably have 100 of them, but we have one for you, too. And by the way, if they're too big for whatever reason, we'll swap them out for you. So isn't that great? Didn't they do a fabulous job? Sergio, Zach, David, and Judge Bauer, we're really honored to have you here today. You made this forum successful once again, and we learned a great deal more than we knew before we came here. We know we're in good hands on all elements, whether it's law school, defense, or prosecution, or the judicial system. We're lucky to have you part. So to our presenters, we all want to say thank you. Thank you. From the Elmhurst College Office of Communications and Public Affairs, let me thank Desiree Chin, the Interim Director of Communications and Public Affairs, Sarah Ramseth, Dina Lynch, Barbara Sedlak, Peggy Cheddar, Tara Palandry, Lauren Atturi, Beverly Crone, who did so much of the work today, and all of our sponsors that made this governmental forum possible. Dr. Braskamp, thank you, and the college administration, faculty, and students, many of whom are here today. Most importantly, I'd like to thank all of you for spending part of your day listening to American Life and Law, Justice in the 21st Century. Our next college events are May 12th, the Shoddy Lecture Series continues with Bridging the Divide. June 7th at 10 a.m. is the 34th annual Blue Jay Backer Golf Outing, Bloomingdale Country Club. And I know Joe Herter would be happy to sell you a ticket, so just talk to him personally. June 16th at 6 p.m., the Chicago Alumni Club's Adler After Dark at the Adler Planetarium. And June 18th at 6:30 is the famous June Jazz on the College Mall, Patty Austin with the Elmhurst College Jazz Band. If you haven't been there before, you want to make it this time. It's a great event and one of the highlights of our year. So please join us at all or more of these events. As Mark Twain observed, 20 years from now, you will be more disappointed by the things that you didn't do than by the ones you did do. So throw off the bow lines, sail away from safe harbor, catch the trade winds in your sails, explore, dream, and discover. Take the journey with us as we serve our students, community, and country. Be safe and travel safe. Thank you.